Okay, so why should we care about EMC of integrated circuits? From the designer's perspective, there is no space for external components, so everything should be inside of the IC. So nobody wants to have external decoupling capacitors, nobody wants to have external filters, especially not in the automotive area. Why? Because every external component is a threat, because it can break due to mechanical stress, due to the thermal stress, and there are no capacitors or resistors who last forever, which last forever. So therefore, everything should be inside of the IC, and that's not that easy. So nowadays we can integrate decoupling capacitors in the chip, but not microfarads. Maybe also microfarads, but it's just a matter of cost. Shielding is often too expensive, especially for electronic products. We do not want to have a big metal housing, and very often you have cables which are entering or going out of the shielding enclosure. Then you have a gap in the shield, and it's not that easy, also from the mechanical perspective. Less PCB layers are wanted. This was the time when I was a student or doing my first electronic designs. A four-layer PCB was very expensive compared to a two-layer PCB. So during these days, everybody wanted to save layers as much as possible. Nowadays, printed circuit boards are not that expensive anymore, and we are very often using multi-layer printed circuit boards where one of the layers is a signal return layer, so a very solid ground plane to act as a shield and to provide a very good signal return path. Yeah, increasing product failures, as I already mentioned, more and more products are failing this CE and FCC requirements. So FCC is basically the same thing as the CE mark from the European Union. It's the American mark for this product is fulfilling all these American specifications. Yeah, for the designers of integrated circuits, the emission and the susceptibility of integrated circuit became a selection criteria. So many years ago, we were selecting ICs mainly due to reasons, price, usually buying the cheapest IC, which is on the market, and based on specifications. So we need a special microcontroller which fulfills certain requirements. But for microcontrollers, there are many manufacturers of microcontrollers available. So you can choose between an Atmel and then whatever, NXP or Renesas or whatever microcontroller. And nowadays, you are not only choosing the microcontroller based on the specification and based on the price. You are also choosing the microcontroller based on its electromagnetic compatibility. So based on the electromagnetic emission this microcontroller is generating, and also based on the fact how robust this microcontroller is. Because in the end, your whole system might be even cheaper if you're using a little bit more expensive microcontroller, but in the end, you do not need so much additional effort to shield and to filter your whole system. So therefore, the EMC behavior of integrated circuits also became a selection criteria to choose ICs. Yeah, time to market is shrinking, so there is usually no additional redesign frame to make some changes on your IC. And especially with the modern technologies, a redesign is absolutely a no-go, because a new mask set costs hundreds of thousands of euros, and nobody's willing to spend additional money. So everything has to be first time right, which is very, very complicated when it's about electromagnetic compatibility. Yeah, cost must be reduced. I think it's clear electromagnetic emission of ICs should be as low as possible, and the susceptibility should be as high as possible, especially in the automotive market, as I mentioned. Just to highlight this a little bit more, we had a bachelor student a couple of years ago, and I gave this bachelor student a task. I said, buy some automotive products, especially smart power high side switches. Any idea what a smart power high side switch is? Okay, switch is clear. So it's an electronic switch, like a big power transistor. And this big power transistor is usually used in cars. many switches are there to, for example, turn on the front light or turn on the windscreen wipers or turn on the ABS system. whatever. So mechanical switches were step by step replaced by electronical switches. And in order to make these switches smart, the switches have some functional safety features included, like a short circuit protection, an over temperature protection, loss of ground protection. So anything that can happen in the normal operation of such a switch is monitored, and usually these switches are reacting then to the problems. So for example, if there is a short circuit, the switch automatically recognizes, hey, there is a short circuit on my output, and then the switch is opened so that the short circuit is broken, also interrupted. Or if there is an over temperature, because there is a short circuit or whatever, the switch internal has a temperature sensor which is recognizing, hey, I have over temperature, and then the switch is opening in order to interrupt the current flow to protect itself. So I gave the student the task, hey, buy some switches from different manufacturers. There are big brands like Infineon, NXP, onsemi, and so on. And make some first investigations and try to figure out how robust are these smart power switches when they are not operated in the normal operation state, when they are operated in a failure mode. For example, bring them into over temperature, so heat the chips up, and try to check if they're really turning off. And the cool thing is all the chips were turning off exactly at the temperature which is defined in the datasheet, which is good, so the protection system is working. And then I said to the student, now, let's inject some RF interferences, some kind of interference signals that can happen during the normal operation of the car when you're driving with your car in an electromagnetic environment. For example, next to the airport, there is the airport radar system, or next to a TV station. All the cable harnesses inside of the cars, they can act as receiving antennas, and then you can interfere maybe the functionality of your devices, especially of the smart power devices. And the interesting thing was the student was then also injecting some RF interferences. You will see the measurement systems and the characterization systems that we have used then in the lectures anyway. And then we checked if this smart power device is really smart, if it also recognizes an over temperature when there is some RF interference. What do you think happened? The problem was that none of these smart power devices was really smart. And now imagine how many millions and billions of smart power devices are currently used in modern cars. Quite a lot. And this is then not that surprisingly that we have more and more problems. Any idea how many cars are every day in Austria on fire? Also, I would not say that this is the main reason, because there is a short circuit and the IC does not recognize the over temperature and doesn't turn off and then it catches fire. So in most of the cases, there is an accident, a cable breaks, or the gasoline tank cracks or whatever. But more and more cases are also reported where the car is just on fire during the normal operation. So you're driving your car and suddenly smoke comes out of the engine compartment. Any idea how many cars are on fire every day in Austria? So maybe sometimes you hear some news, there is a traffic jam because a car is on fire or something.
One.
One, okay. Yeah, the thing is the statistic says about 10 cars every day. So maybe all this functional safety features, well, they are good, they are perfect, they are needed, but maybe they are not always working right, especially in the presence of interferences. And it's not just only RF interference. Electrostatic discharges, for example, is also a big threat to electronic components. Especially during winter time, maybe you have already experienced this when you're getting off the car or getting on the car, especially when you're getting off, you get an electric shock by electrostatic discharge. Have you experienced this? Yeah, now imagine this electrostatic discharge is not from the fingertip into the chassis. It goes from the fingertip into the control module by the cable harness. Or especially when you're getting in the car and you don't have this, have this start engine button because you have a Toyota RAV4, you have to put your key. You're holding the key, you're electrostatically charged up to whatever, 10,000 kilovolt. And now you're putting the key into your, what is this called in English? Key inlet point, keynote, what is it called? And then there is an electrostatic discharge from the key into this metallic frame of the key. And there is usually a lot of electronic systems behind. It's not just the ignition thing, it's also the Wegfahrsperre. Anti-thief protection system or whatever. So it could happen that you're interfering by an electrostatic discharge with the normal functionality of your systems. So this should give you some introduction why this topic is important and why we are working pretty much at our institutes to handle these topics or to handle these problems and bring up some information how we can design electronic systems in the future which are a little bit more robust and reliable.